Well, every year, I attend the Willow Creek Leadership Summit at a local satellite location. It's consistently one of the highlights of my year. I know that several of you also attend, and I know it's a highlight for you. The opening presenter each year is Bill Hybels, founder and senior pastor of Willow Creek Community Church. And because of his history of wise, successful, and godly leadership, you can always count on him to be thought-provoking and challenging and inspiring. In 2015, his presentation was titled The Five Intangibles of Leadership. He spoke about five intangibles that don't often get our attention, but he said are subtle essentials. The idea was that whatever your life or your mission is about, you must develop and demonstrate what he called grit. That was the first of the five essentials, and it really got my attention. And I think it's mainly because I like the sound of that word, grit. He said that if you that grit can be defined as perseverance and passion over the long haul, and that anyone who wants can develop grit. It is developed every time you overcome an obstacle with tenacity and perseverance. And he repeated throughout his talk, grit demands difficulty. It turns out that the arch enemy of grit is ease. And he said, if as parents we turn over heaven and earth to make our kids' lives easy, stress-free, and challenge-free, we do them no favors regarding grit. Well, grit had my attention. It was definitely one of my takeaways that year at the summit. This past May, Angela Duckworth published a book called Grit, The Power of Passion and Perseverance. The book has been described as a roadmap to greatness and immediately became a New York Times bestseller. Duckworth talks about grit and other character traits such as self-control, delayed gratification, and optimism as part of what she calls resume strengths. She said that grit can be developed, strengthened, taught, and learned. Well, the idea of grit, which first got my attention from Bill Hybels at the Leadership Summit, was reinforced by Angela Duckworth, who says that while grit is only one aspect of character, it is an intangible but essential predictor of success. Grit development demands difficulty. I like to think that I have grit because I regularly take on difficult tasks. But I have to say that grit has not always been one of my strengths. Several years ago, I bought a home in Michigan on 3/4 acre. And it was a Tudor-style home, and I mentioned that architecture style because while it was really cute, that architecture style created a lot of challenge in the process of fixing up the home. If you're not familiar with the Tudor style, the characteristics that provided the challenge were just all these angles and gabled roofs. The siding on the home was made from cedar shakes, and because of the dampness in Michigan, when we bought the home, rather than that beautiful cedar color, the shakes had collected moisture and were an ugly gray. And so as soon as that first summer arrived, we decided to power wash the outside of the house to restore the natural color of the siding. And so we rented a power washer and this other kind of machine that was like, I don't even know the official name, but it was like a lift. And maybe it's just called a lift. I don't even know. But my sons could put the power washer in, and then it would lift them up to get to all those difficult and challenging angles to power wash. And, of course, I keep saying we. All that I did was pay to rent for the equipment. My sons were the ones who actually did the work. At the time, they were ages 22. 20, and 17. This job really should have taken a day and a half, but because I only wanted to pay for one day of the equipment, they needed to, in one day, figure out how to operate the power washer, the lift, and get it up into all these angles. And on top of that, it started raining that morning. And so for anyone who has two or more sons, you know that this scenario just creates a perfect storm for brothers. Well, I decided to stay safely in the house and make food during the procedure. But every so often, I kind of looked out into the gray, stormy weather and saw what looked like a scary circus to me. But it ended up that at the end of the day, sure enough, the house was totally power washed and the beautiful cedar color was restored with no major accidents. Well, the next project was to seal the cedar shakes. And again, this time I'll say we, and I was part of it at this time. We chose to seal the cedar shakes with paintbrushes. We got this sealant, and we thought that if we went square by square on each of the cedar shakes, that they would be well sealed and that we would not have to do this task again for 10 years. And so I worked on the decks and the other areas that could be reached by standing on the ground, while my boys used ladders to get to all the other parts of the house. And I think that regular, normal people would have rented that lift again, but I wanted to save money. And so my boys used ladders. And when the ladders could no longer reach, they became very resourceful and positioned themselves on the angles of the home, actually leaning out with their belts hanging around their neck, holding the cans of sealant. And I am not kidding. I saw this with my own eyes, even though I couldn't watch very much of it. Well, there's actually a point to the story that has to do with grit. The process of sealing the cedar shakes went on for weeks and weeks, and we had to finish before winter came. Otherwise, all the work we had done would be wasted. So the two older boys left home in the fall, and Jason and I were left to finish sealing the house. And to be fair, I should say mostly Jason, but on Sundays, we got out there with our paintbrushes and square by square continued applying the sealant. The job seemed unending, and one particular Sunday, we said, we are going to finish no matter what. So we worked all day and into the evening, and eventually it started getting dark, and it was really difficult to see, but we were still at it. Grit, the power of passion and perseverance over the long haul. At that moment, I was losing whatever grit I had. All I wanted to do was be done with this house. And I remember saying to Jason, "Jace, I can't do anymore." Silence. And then his response, "This is when you do your best work." Clearly, he is the grittier one. Here's what I know. When it comes to grit or character, we admire people who demonstrate it. Their stories of overcoming obstacles inspire us. Eric Weyenmeyer, for example, summited each of the 7 highest peaks on each of the 7 continents, including Mount Everest. To do this task, mountaineers consider this a challenge. Eric Weyenmeyer did this as a blind man. Stories like Eric's inspire us to want grit and to believe that we too can overcome great obstacles. In the spring of 2017, many in this room signed up to run a half marathon. Prior to this time, many of us had only gone 13.1 miles by car. We signed up to train and we began our training with fear. But we learned the difference between good pain and bad pain, and we trained in the heat of the summer and in the cool of the fall mornings. And many of you remember, on that October morning of race day, we ran 13.1 miles. And if you were part of that group, you were part of a process that developed grit. You persevered with passion, you overcame obstacles, and you remember that feeling of discovering that you really could do more than you thought you could do. Well, overcoming physical challenges is one way to grow grit, and when you grow grit in any area, it flows over into other areas as well. Truly, grit can be developed, strengthened, taught, and learned. Grit is the power of passion and perseverance over the long haul. Sometimes we choose to engage in experiences that develop grit and develop character, but sometimes those experiences seem to choose us. And for the rest of our time together, I want to shift to those kinds of experiences and opportunities to develop the very same kind of grit and character that you develop when you choose to train and to stretch yourself But in experiences that we often overlook or stumble over or that frustrate us and that overall we wish would never happen, even though they are the stuff that develops grit and character. I'm talking about experiences that range from waiting in an incredibly long line at Costco to regularly driving in rush hour traffic or being woken up night after night by a baby or a sick child or the frustration of a day that gets off track because projects are taking longer than you thought they would or people are running late. Experiences that range from those everyday kinds of frustrations to things like an unfulfilling job, a relationship that's stuck, an unexpected diagnosis, an unplanned pregnancy, or a financial decision that goes bad. These inescapable experiences tend to undo us and sometimes make us question whether God and his involvement in our lives. Do we dare entertain the idea that these experiences are actually potential opportunities to develop grit and character, and that if we entertain that idea that our stories could be a story that inspires people? Because these experiences are ones that happen to all of us, we have to do more than just entertain the idea. We have to embrace the idea because struggle and pain and frustration are the human experience. 2,000 years ago, James, the brother of Jesus, wrote a letter to the young Christian church with some insight into these kinds of experiences that frustrate us and devastate us. And I mentioned that James was Jesus' brother because I think that gives James unique credibility. Having watched Jesus grow up, he writes from a perspective that sets him apart from the other New Testament writers. And whether or not you're here today as a Christian, or whether or not you're sure of what you think of the Bible, it might interest you to read a book, and it's actually a letter, a historic document that was written by the brother of Jesus. And here's what's so powerful about James's experience and what he has to say. If you know anything about brothers, and I feel that after having raised three sons that I know something about brothers, I know that if one of my sons had claimed to be the Son of God, it would not have gone over well. And it seems that this was James's experience. Matthew mentions James in Matthew 13. And he mentions James and three of Jesus' other brothers. James' name comes first, presumably meaning that he was the oldest of the brothers. Matthew mentions him again at the time that Jesus visits their home in Nazareth, and where people just were not buying that Jesus was the Son of God. People thought he was doing some kooky things, and James was apparently one of those people. He didn't buy that his brother was the Son of God until his brother was raised from the dead. The resurrection of Jesus changed everything for James. Paul wrote that Jesus actually met with James after the resurrection, and James became a leader of the young church. Well, James wrote a very practical letter to the church, and I like to think about the book of James as James saying, I watched my brother grow up, and this is what I think it looks like to be a Christian from having eyewitnessed my own brother grow up, and he is the Son of God. He was who he claimed to be. So I want us to turn to James 1, and James is a little book toward the end of the New Testament after a bigger book called Hebrews. I love the way James begins his letter, especially when you know his history. James 1, he says, James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, greetings. I just love what happened to James. And then he says, consider it pure joy. Joy, that emotion you feel when family arrives for Christmas. Joy is the look in your little boy's eyes when you say he gets the puppy, or that feeling inside of you when you get straight A's on your report card, or when you get an unexpected raise, a sizable one, those things are joy. James says, consider it pure joy, not just joy, but pure joy, whenever you face trials of many kinds. consider trials joy. James, if you knew about the things in my life that frustrated me and that were difficult, I don't think you would ask me to consider those things joy. And if you knew about the things that happened in our church, the things that are going on right now that are devastating people's lives, I don't think you would tell us to consider these things joy. Sometimes this, well, I should say usually, always, this isn't how we find joy. And sometimes we don't say it out loud, but when we're struggling and when these kinds of things happen that are difficult, the opposite of joy happens for us. We wonder if God is really good. We wonder if we can trust him, if he's really all-powerful. We don't wake up in the morning expecting to struggle. And when we do, we don't consider it joy. We just want it over with quick. James isn't the only one who writes like this. The Apostle Peter says, "Dear friends, do not be surprised by the fiery ordeal that has come on to test you, as though some strange thing were happening to you." For me, no matter how challenging and difficult a day is, I go to bed every night hoping that the next day is just going to be good and smooth and I can move through my to-do list. But Peter is cautioning, don't be surprised when you're stretched or frustrated or even devastated by life as though some strange thing were happening. Expect it. Bible writers aren't the only ones who teach this. Before C.S. Lewis became the great Christian apologist and author, he was an atheist. He thought deeply and logically, and after his conversion to Christianity, he preached and wrote from a uniquely powerful perspective. C.S. Lewis lived through the horror of both World War I and World War II. Just after the beginning of World War II, he preached to an audience, many of whom, because of the devastation and fear and trouble in which they lived, had begun to think that life was pointless. He titled his sermon, "Learning in Wartime," and he made a point that resonates with Peter's instruction to expect trouble and with James, who asks us to consider trials joy. C.S. Lewis says this. He says, "We are mistaken when we compare war with normal life. Life has never been normal. War makes death real to us, and that would have been regarded as one of its blessings by most of the great Christians of the past. They thought it good for us to be always aware of our mortality. I am inclined to think they were right. All schemes of happiness that centered in this world were always doomed to final frustration. In ordinary times, only a wise man can realize this. Now," and he's speaking of wartime, "the stupidest of us know." We see unmistakably the sort of universe in which we have all along been living and must come to terms with it. If we had foolish, unchristian hopes about human culture, they are now shattered. If we thought we were building up a heaven on earth, if we looked for something that would turn the present world from a place of pilgrimage into a permanent city satisfying the soul of man, we are disillusioned. C.S. Lewis suggests that we are disillusioned to think that the purpose of life is to be heaven on earth, to satisfy our souls, or in other words, that this life could possibly just be smooth and good. C.S. Lewis, Peter, and James, as well as other Bible writers, teach that the reality for the follower of Jesus is from the perspective that trials and sufferings are blessings that serve to anchor us to the Christian reality that this world is broken. And while a day will come when we will have only goodness, right now we only enjoy moments of goodness. One day when Jesus returns, all things will be made new, but for now, don't be surprised by trouble because this world isn't heaven. Well, James had the privilege of watching Jesus grow up. He saw Jesus face trials that range from frustrations to devastation. And James writes his letter about trials and suffering of every kind from that perspective. He says, consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith, and I just find this interesting that James is talking about trials of many kinds testing our faith. A lot of times we think about big things like the loss of a job as a test of our faith, and that truly is a test of our faith. We don't often give the same weight and credibility to smaller things that happen, but they are truly part of trials of many kinds. We don't often consider that the irritations of every day, like waiting for someone who's consistently late or waking up several times in a night, or the ongoing frustrations in the workplace, are actually trials of our faith. When these kinds of things happen, whatever it is that stirs inside of me are part of my faith, equally as when something big happens that gets our attention and we know our faith is being tested. The things that stir inside us when we face everyday frustrations are truly about our faith. What is it that you feel? What is stirring inside of you when you're stretched? Are we supposed to say something or not say something? Do we believe that God is good? Do we believe He cares? Do my faith and beliefs and convictions matter in everyday irritations as well as in the bigger things that happen? James would say yes, and he goes on to tell us why. He says, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance, that component of grit. Trials of many kinds hold as much opportunity to develop grit as training for an extreme sport holds opportunity to develop grit. The difference is that while we might choose to train for an extreme sport and in the process develop grit, we don't choose these kinds of experiences that stretch us. But what if we realized that trials of many kinds are actually opportunities to develop the same kind of grit and character that can be developed when you choose to stretch yourself? The word that James used that was translated as perseverance portrayed the idea of steadfastness, endurance, and constancy in the face of many kinds of trials. And this means that the seemingly small, ongoing irritations and frustrations in our lives are not small at all. They are equal opportunities to bigger things. Earlier we said that developing grit in any area touches other areas as well. Developing perseverance through any experience touches other experiences so that truly nothing we go through is insignificant. Developing grit in the small, everyday experiences of life increases the chances that when you face bigger things, you'll be ready. James continues, let perseverance finish its work so that you may be complete, or so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. Perseverance over the long haul develops strong, solid character and remains steadfast and constant through small irritations and large, painful struggles. It develops grit. This kind of character is developed through facing obstacle after obstacle and seemingly impossible adversity over a long period of time. It's the kind of character that when we hear its story, we're inspired with hope and possibility. Well, the Bible is full of all kinds of stories of people who let perseverance finish its work and develop strong, steadfast, and constant character. Among these stories is Joseph in the Old Testament, who was sold into slavery by his jealous brothers and was removed from everything familiar and everything he loved. And then, as though slavery weren't enough, he was accused of something that he didn't do, and he was thrown into a dark Egyptian prison. Joseph allowed perseverance to do its work through trials of many kinds, and that prepared him to eventually become second in command in Egypt. King David is another person in the Old Testament, an example of developing character through trials of many kinds. As a young boy, he cared for sheep day after day, including fighting off wild animals. As a young man, he was anointed to be king of Israel and then endured being hunted and having to hide in caves for years. During that time, he wrote many of the Psalms that became part of the Bible, just pouring out the desperateness of his heart to God. And he would repeatedly tell God that he didn't understand, what he was going through didn't make sense, and he repeatedly would come back around to a position of submission and perseverance that developed a strong, steady, and constant character that made him the wise king that he was. Spending time with stories like these is actually a legitimate way of developing grit and learning to develop character. Today, we would say that Joseph and David had grit. They demonstrated the power of passion and perseverance over the long haul. The words, "let perseverance finish its work," kind of have a passive ring to them, as though things like just being stuck in traffic day after day and year after year in and of themselves develop grit, or working with difficult people every day, or getting together with dysfunctional family at the holidays year after year in and of themselves develop character. We all know people, though, who do difficult things all the time, and rather than having developed grit and character, become bitter, angry, paralyzed, and hopeless people. Sometimes those people are us. Perseverance doesn't just happen. It's what we choose to do during trials of many kinds that develops perseverance that will eventually become character. In her book, Rising Strong, Brené Brown describes a process that, for me, describes what it looks like to let perseverance finish its work. And I want to share a little of it as a way of just creating context. In times that we are struggling and just experiencing pain and difficulty, our culture teaches us to deny that it hurts, to deny that it's hard, to just keep going and get over it. And so to survive, what happens is that we disown the real story to appear whole and on top of things and in control. And in place of our real stories that we're actually struggling, we tell ourselves a different story. We tell ourselves a story of being calloused. I'm the only one in the workplace who even cares about deadlines. Or people just are who they are. There's nothing that can be done. Or God could have done something and he chose not to be involved. And because of telling ourselves other stories than the real story of struggle that's happening inside of us, instead of letting perseverance finish its work so that we develop character through experiences of life, or as James put it, through trials of many kinds, our struggles end up defining us, and we become bitter and frustrated and hopeless. Rather than facing our real story of loneliness, boredom, or disappointment, we disengage to self-protect. But the real stories and emotions don't go away. Without being acknowledged, they fester and grow and lead to behaviors that are completely out of line with whom we want to be, and to ways of thinking that sabotage everything we value. To let perseverance finish its work, we have to become willing to challenge and reality check those stories that we're telling ourselves so that we move from our first responses of denial and blame to a deeper understanding of our own thoughts, feelings, and behaviors. And then, instead of disowning and denying the real stories, trials of many kinds can transform us and build character and grit. Well, there are two deceptively simple parts to this process. The first, engage with our feelings. And the second, get curious about the story behind the feelings. What does it mean to engage with our feelings? A button is pushed. You experience a sense of disappointment. Anger washes over you. Your heart races. Something tells you that all is not well. You're experiencing a feeling, some kind of emotion. And the good news is that engaging with emotion or engaging with our feelings is that we don't have to pinpoint the specific emotion accurately. We just need to recognize that we're feeling something. And as I said, this is deceptively simple because it's often right at this point that we just start to feel something, that we start disengaging from the real story of what's happening. Our default is to offload whatever we're feeling with the quickest relief we can find. Sometimes it's food. It can be relationships or money or work or chaos. It can be shopping or planning. It can be the internet. It can be just staying busy. It happens automatically. And so engaging with emotion has to be learned. In the soonest moment, though, that you recognize something is happening inside you, that something's off, and with practice, it comes sooner and sooner. But in that moment that you become aware that something is on the inside happening, put what might be a free-floating feeling into some kind of language. And it could look something like this. I don't know what's happening, but I just want to hide. I just know I want to hit something. I want ice cream, a lot of it. I feel, fill in the blank, disappointed, heartbroken, confused. I am, fill in the blank, in a lot of pain, embarrassed, overwhelmed. My stomach is in knots. My closest friend just ignored me, and I'm feeling something between anger and fear. And it might take some practice, but these kinds of things are things that we can become aware of. And to engage with our feelings means that we just develop some awareness about how we're thinking and how we're feeling and how we're behaving, and that those things are actually connected. The goal is just to simply recognize that that we have emotions and that some kind of feeling is in play. So that's step one, engage with our feelings. And then step two, get curious about the story behind the feelings. And in other words, just get curious about your experience. And the good news is that here as well, you don't need to pinpoint it exactly. You just need to learn. You just need to want to learn more. It could be as simple as asking yourself questions like these. Why am I being so hard on everyone around me today? What's setting me off? How did I get to the point that I want to hit something? I can't stop thinking about that conversation. Why? I'm having such a strong emotional reaction. Why? I know the ice cream isn't going to work. What's really happening? As you lean into the curiosity, just jot down some notes on your experience. It doesn't have to be anything fancy. It can be a bullet point list on a piece of scrap paper or a simple paragraph in your journal. And an interesting thing is it can be an effective core of your writing to answer some or all of the following six ideas. And this is about just what's happening to us instead of the real thing. The story I'm making up. My emotions. You could just jot down a word. My body. My thinking. Jot down a word, jot down a phrase. My beliefs. My actions. You can write a word, a phrase, a sentence, or more for some or all of these things. Translating messy, difficult experiences into language makes them graspable so that we can connect the dots. And we can do something with it. Writing helps us organize our experience. Research has shown that even a few minutes of writing can bring significant results. In the moment of struggle, when things are not clear, writing even a note on a piece of scrap paper gives us a chance to pause and evaluate what we're thinking and feeling. And in some cases, this is all we need to connect with the real story that's happening inside of us. Well, this might sound too simple to be effective, but I really want to encourage you to give it a try before you make that decision. Engaging with our feelings and becoming curious about the story behind our feelings take courage. Read the Psalms that David wrote. His writing is actually a very similar kind of writing to what we're talking about. This is the path that leads to wholeness, that leads to solid, steadfast character. Engaging with emotion and becoming curious about the story behind our feelings is how we let perseverance finish its work. Well, the process requires wisdom, and our passage in James concludes with these words. If any of you lacks wisdom, you should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to you. In the midst of the trial, whatever you're feeling about yourself, whatever you're feeling about other people or the circumstances that you're in, as you begin to engage with your feelings and get curious about the story that you're telling yourself, James encourages us with who God is. God is not about finding fault. He's about giving generously. If you ask, he'll generously give wisdom about your feelings, about your thoughts, about where to turn, what to do. In that moment that you become aware of frustration and struggle of any kind, James says, ask God for wisdom, and he'll give it generously. Trials of many kinds, as James puts it, come to everyone. No one is spared. And I hope that you take home two things from today. One, perspective. Perspective that Jesus' followers hold, that perseverance in trials of many kinds over the long haul is the Christian perspective in this world, and that this is what develops grit and character and grounds us to the reality that this world is not heaven. And the second thing, payoff. There will be a payoff for perseverance. We all suffer in this life, but the Christian suffers knowing that one day there will be no more suffering and no more pain. We persevere with the hope in the reality that all things will be made right and all things will be made new. Perspective and payoff. Among the stories of perseverance that all of us know, and many of them are just incredible and inspiring stories, one that I have recently read is the story of a young Jewish girl from Poland at the time of World War II. Her name was Tosia Altman. She was known as a talented youth leader in her community. When the war broke out and the Jews were ordered to evacuate her city, she became part of a resistance movement that embraced the belief that the Jews should not go to their deaths without a fight. Let us not go like sheep to the slaughter were the words of their manifesto. Tosia Altman internalized the spirit of resistance. Her perseverance, her character, and her story are at the same time both inspiring and horrific. Displayed at the World Holocaust Center in Jerusalem are words that she wrote. Perhaps precisely in this, that a doomed man in the final moment of his existence, as he glances into the abyss of annihilation with eyes stretched wide in horror, grasps the beauty of life and the power of creation. These words capture the essence of what can happen for the Christian in the midst of our own trials of many kinds that may range from simple irritations to profound devastation and at times even horror, that we hold the perspective of the beauty of life and the power of creation that exists only in moments in this life, but that will be found one day in the payoff of heaven. One day, all things will be made right and will be made new. In the words of James, consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. If any of you lacks wisdom, you should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to you. Let's pray together. Our Father, as we just sit in this quiet moment, we pray that these words of James that were inspired by watching his brother Jesus will be like seeds that water our hearts, that they will grow and bear fruit. We pray that as we face trials of many kinds. And I pray over every person in this room because I know that we each face trials of many kinds. I pray that we would persevere. I pray that your Spirit would prompt us to turn to you and ask for wisdom. And we are comforted and grateful to know that in that moment of need, that you do not find fault, but that you give generously to us. We thank you for this. In Jesus' name, amen.